with you in the word. Amen. Amen. So he went down. I'm going to tell you a story. A story about a teacup. I learned this in Beacon College. I can't remember which one of my classmates gave the story. And there was a story about this teacup. This ball of clay was sitting on the shelf. The ball of clay was content. She saw the other balls of clay getting taken down and being molded and turned. And she was like, ooh, that looked like it hurt. I'm glad he didn't pick me. And then he would put that clay in this furnace. Because when you're molding clay and you're going to make it into something, it's got to be burnt. It's got to be so the clay will hold what it's getting ready to hold. So he would put that clay into the furnace. And she was like, no, I'm glad he didn't pick me. That looked like it's hot. It's nice and cool and comfortable right where I am. Then he would take that cup out. And then he was like, ooh, there's too much clay on this. He would begin to cut some stuff off. Ooh, he cutting on it. Ooh, that looked like it hurt. No, I don't want it. So one day, all the other balls of clay was gone. She looked to her left. Wasn't nobody there. She looked to her right. Wasn't nobody there. She got a little nervous. Her knees started shaking. You know how some of us do? And when Doc be looking around at the end of service and it's time to pray, and she looks at y'all, and y'all don't want to pray, y'all be looking down. Please don't call me. So this ball of clay is sitting there, and she's like, please don't let him pick up. Man, he's sick today. I don't know what he doing. No. Then she heard the door open, and he came, and he looked around. He went on and turned the furnace on. He gathered his materials together, and he went and snatched that ball of clay off that shelf. And he began to mold to it. And he began to mold it. And she's like, oh, this is hurting. Will you please stop? I don't like this. You're hurting me. It's hurting. And he began to mold it. And then before he put it in the furnace, he began to cut some stuff off. And then he put her on this wheel. And they began to turn around, and she was dizzy. She's like, oh, he done molded me, he done cut me. Now he got me on this wheel. I'm going around and around. I'm dizzy. I feel sick. I don't know which way is up. You ever been like that? You don't know which way is up. You done been through all that you can do, and you think you're about to lose your mind, and then all of a sudden it stopped. And you think, whew, I can catch my breath. And then something else happens. Puts you in the fire. And you're thinking, oh my God, this is right here. This is when I'm going to die. This is it. This is it. I'm going to die in this furnace. Oh, you ever had so much trouble hit you all at once? You think the last things were going to take you out. But this right here, this is sure enough to take you out. You either going to die. Because you can't take it, or you either gonna take your own life because things are so happening to you. And then finally, he looks, he taps on it, makes sure it's sturdy, his Doc was saying so, and he takes it out of the furnace, and he lets it cool, and he leaves, and he comes back the next day, and she's sitting there, this little cup in a different form, in a different shape. And he begins to look at on his table at the paints and the different ornaments that he could put on this cup. And he begins to paint her. And she begins to feel worthy. She begins to feel useful. And he begins to put pretty little things on her. And then he sets her down in a china store, and she's sold for thousands of dollars. So why did I tell you the story of this teacup? This prophet, he went down to this potter to see a sermon formed. Sometimes you're the sermon that somebody needs to see. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you're the word of God that somebody needs to see walk it out. Not everybody you come across is going to pick up a Bible. Not everybody. I am Specialist Jamel Chantel Pratt. I'm 71 Lima 10. That means I was an administrative specialist. In 1998, the spring, I was raped by 6 soldiers. Active duty. I suffer from military sexual trauma. I'm a divorced twice. I have 3 children. All of my children have at one time either thought of or attempted suicide. I have attempted suicide 5 times and failed. Praise the Lord. So the things that rape, I thought was going to kill me. Being molested at 11 years old by my uncle didn't kill me. Having to endure one mother's horrible fate that you think will never happen, someone messing with your child, I thought that would kill me. Being homeless, being a battered woman, being all these things, I thought all of these things would kill me. Waking up day in, day out, having nightmares and trauma, I thought all of these things would kill me. But for someone out there who lives the way that I do, either post-traumatic stress or military sexual trauma or any type of trauma, they see me walk it out. They see me get up every day. They see me pray. As Doc say, Jamel, you can pray the horns off a billy goat. I just know I had to pray. I had to be able to pray. I have to be able to stand before you and be able to tell you that God is good regardless of what you're going through. I have to be able to tell you, even though I was in that furnace, even though I was being molded, even though I was being shaped and formed, and there was sometimes during my walk, God was not pleased with me. So what did he do? He threw me down. He skull drugged me. He picked me back in, and he began to form me again. Because see, when the potter is not happy with the clay, what does he do? He takes it up again and reforms it. And when he begins to reform it, you're created into something different. Just like it says in the Bible, we are created in Christ Jesus. Therefore, we are a new creature. So when we begin to become this new creature, I am not the Jamel I was when I graduated in 1990 from Southern Wayne High School. I am not the Jamel that married George McNair. I'm not the Jamel that married Jeremy Pratt. I am not that Jamel that was raped. I am not no longer a victim. I am victorious in the word of Christ Jesus. Amen. Like what? No. But in the back of my mind, I'm like, one of these roll up on me, it's going to be a bad day. You know, that's what I think. God tell you, don't roll up on Jamel wrong now. She ain't wrapped too tight. She tells you that. But anyway, so he goes down to this potter's. And in the Bible, it tells you that sometimes these potters, they were shifty, some of them were shifty now. We got some shifty Christians. And they would take broken pottery and they wouldn't glue it back together right. So you know how you can tell a counterfeit bill? You have to hold it up to the light, right? Those of us who handle money all the time, you take that $100 bill and you can hold it up to the light and you can tell if it's real or not. Just like with a Christian, when you hold this Christian up to the word of God, you can be able to tell and discern a counterfeit from a fake. Now, there's people walking around with knockoff bags. I did not know anything about a knockoff bag until I got to the Classic 2 or 3 years ago, and my daughter bought a bag. Stop laughing because she knows the story. We bought a bag. It was cute. It was a Michael Kors backpack. When I say that thing was so cute, $45, right? Michael Kors backpack. We bought it on Saturday. We came to church on Sunday. Before she got out of church on Sunday, that bag was tore up. It was a counterfeit. So let's look at a counterfeit Christian. If a counterfeit Christian who had a false or just an emotional experience with Jesus Christ in church service. Hands was filled. The choir sang. The preacher preached. They just crying. They snot-nosed crying. They came up to the altar. They shook the hand. They came back, got baptized. They went on the water, a dry center. And guess what? They came up a wet center. Why? Because there was no true repentance. There was no power. There was no substance. There was nothing there to hold them tightly to this word of God. See, I can't make it without the word of God. I got to pray. I got to laugh and take my medicine and exercise and eat right and sleep. Those are six things that I got to do every day. Because if I don't, my children will tell you, you're not. And those who are close to me, they know. And they're right. You know, Miss Ebony be like, Miss Jamelia, you had your medicine today? I'm going to need you to go home and get that. There ain't but a couple in here that can tell me that. Because they close to me. Because I know if I'm hungry, Miss Ebony going to feed me. Or she going to get my kids so I don't kill them. Because I'm having a bad day. Not that I would kill them for real, but you don't know. I'm having a bad day. I had my medicine today, so y'all good. I'm good. But anyway, so he goes down to this potter's house and he's watching this potter shape this clay. And he's holding it up to the light. And there's no cracks in it. Can you be held up to the light today and nobody see any cracks?
No.
I'm just saying.
Amen.
I can't judge you. Only God can judge you. I'm not going to rebuke you. Only your pastor can do that. I can just give you what God has given me. So he goes down and he's looking. Now, in Jeremiah 17, he had preached at the gates. Or in the previous chapters, he had preached at the gates. But in this message, he's being preached to. This man didn't say a word. He's just sitting there doing his job. So if you are in ministry or if you belong to a church, if you're standing at the door and doing exactly what you're supposed to do, ushering in the Holy Spirit and greeting people with a nice smile and a nice word, then you're doing what you're supposed to do. If you're standing up here singing praises unto his name, worship him in the spirit and in truth, then you're doing what you're supposed to do. If me, an elder, and Pastor McMillan, and Elder Ola, and Pastor is doing what we're supposed to do, then we are interceding for you. We are preaching, we are studying, we are on our face, and sometimes we got to get and push back the plate. Why? So that you can get this word into your heart and mind, so that you can let loose the yokes and the burdens and the things that are tying you to sin and the things that you just won't let go. Now, I can't make you stop with the puff, puff, pass, and I can't stop you from going to Motel 6 with somebody else's wife or husband, but I can tell you that it ain't going to work. I'm just here. Be like, no, I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't do that. I remember Pastor saying one time, what would your family say if they had to go get your body out of the hotel? I thought about that because I'm a single woman. I'm like, ooh. Because I know how my pastor is, so I can imagine how that sermon, that eulogy would go.
Uh-oh. Mm.
Yeah, y'all know who she is now. She gonna get my Facebook. She gonna open it. She gonna read my text messages. She gonna look at my pictures. She gonna do all of that. Had I been found dead in a hotel with somebody else's husband or a husband that's not mine, mind you, I'm single. But the Lord God took this clay, which is me right now, and molded me and fashioned me to whom you see stand before you. He took a sinner, a hoe. Yeah, I said a hoe. I was promiscuous, even though I had been raped. He took a drunk, a liar, a thief, a bad mother. I still can't cook. He hasn't fixed that. But he took, can't have everything. He did give me the gift of prayer. So gift of prayer, gift of cook. I'll take the prayer. Because I can pray for somebody else to cook me. Amen. Amen. So, the potter is sent to the house not to preach a sermon, but as before, as the gate says, I said, but those not to study their sermons, but to have them. He adds this by the immediate inspiration. He said, go to the potter's house and observe how he managed his work. And there I will cause thee by the silent whispers to hear my words. There are those that receive a message to be delivered by the people. Note there are those who would know God's mind must observe his appointments and attend where they hear his words. So if you're in the right place at the right time and you're watching a man or woman of God, they don't have to say anything. They don't have to be up here in this pulpit. Everybody who's called to ministry ain't a preacher. Y'all didn't catch that. Everybody who's called to ministry is not a preacher.
All right. Amen.
We need some teachers. We need some administrators. We need somebody to push a broom.
Amen.
We need somebody to drive the van.
Amen.
We need some more voices up here in the choir.
Well, amen.
You know, I ain't in the choir. I can't sing. I'm tone deaf. So I don't sing. I don't count money because I can't count all the time. If you work out with me, you'll know that. And I don't cook. But what I do is if you're cooking, I will give you the money. I will go to the store. If I got good stuff, name brand, top of the line, because I want to eat good because I'm hungry. So, or if you need to be singing, I'll go get the batteries, I'll buy the CD, I'll copy the CDs, whatever. You need a van, I will wash, me and TJ will wash the van. No, let me rephrase that. I will take TJ and he will wash and clean the van.
All right.
Which he's done. Whichever. So I can be of help, even in the areas that I can't do. So I handle the not singing. I'll get some batteries. Y'all need some batteries. We good? I can't cook, so I'm going to make sure Ebony and Londa got everything they need for Thanksgiving dinner, because I'm going to eat right. And the van. Well, we need some more maintenance on the van. Okay. I'm going to have to pay for oil changes or some tires or something, because I don't drive a van. I can, but you see where I'm going with this? There are things that you can do. What has God molded and fashioned you to do? Are you a van driver? Then drive a van. Are you an usher? Then get out there on the door. Mm-hmm. Who was out there today? Trey. Now, let's just say, Lord forbid, had a gunman came out there, is Trey going to be able to stop him? How many men we got? We got Zach. We got Pastor McMillan. We got Ricardo. Well, we already had the event. I forgot my baby's name. We already had the evangelist out there a couple of Sundays. Minister Leo is singing and doing media. He can't, and he teaches children's church. We got Deacon Willie. So next Sunday, I'm not rebuking you. I'm just saying, because I can't do it. I'm just making observation. We're going to have some other men out there on the go. Right?
Amen.
And in a few more Sundays, especially starting in 2018, we're going to have some more men driving the van.
Amen.
Right? Amen. This, I'm not rebuking you. I'm just making observations. Okay. So, what have you been fashioned to do? You been fashioned to sweep the floor? How many can sweep a floor? I'm a country girl. I'm from North, Miley, North Carolina, the capital of Pibbles. So I say fluff. I don't say more. I say fluff. You sweet fluff. Then Friday night or Wednesday night, get with me and you can come in here and help me sweep the floor. I don't mind sweeping the floor. I like it because I get to get in here, me and my children, and we pray and we get out. We pray, we clean, we out. What has he fashioned you to do? Can you play an instrument? I know ain't nobody in here that can play the keyboard and you sitting in over there, and other than Pastor McMillan, we know he can play. But I know there's nobody other anybody else sitting out there and not up here, right? There ain't nobody? Okay, just making sure. So, what have you fashioned you to do? Are you fashioned for his will? So let's ask yourself a couple questions. Are you willing to be fashioned? Because that clay, she had to be taken hostage. I wasn't willing. I was stationed in Korea. And I'm getting ready to close. Yep. Well, stationed in Korea, and I got a Red Cross message. My mother, who was raising my oldest daughter, Katie, at the time, she had already had a kidney transplant, and she had a mass on her brain. They gave her 6 days to live. 6 days. I was devastated. I stood in my office with an E7, an E8, an E6, and an E5. I went in there, and I said some choice words, which I will not repeat. And I said, I need y'all to get out my office, because I need to talk to God. They got their covers, their hats, and left me alone. And I told God, I said, God, you can't take my mama from me right now. I need at least another year. This was January of 2000. January 8th, matter of fact, of 2000. Can't take her. I'm not emotionally, I'm not mentally, I'm not, I can't. I don't know how to raise a child. I don't know nothing about that. You can't take her from me right now. So while I'm in there talking to God, any kind of way, because I ain't know no better. My NCO, my officer, and my colonel was handling my Red Cross message. They got my plane ticket. They called my husband at the time and got him off, and we all went home. Mind you, I was pregnant with Jarell. I was devastated. That was January 8th, 2000. Mind you, I asked God to give me one more year. January 8th, 2001, after she had spent Christmas with me and I took her back on New Year's Eve night, my mother died. God gave me just what I asked for. He had fashioned me in that year time to do and to stand. Because my mother had me up at 5 every morning and prayed. Not just walking around praying. No, baby, you got to get on your knees or lay flat on your face and pray. You don't know what to pray, then you need to read the Bible the night before. You need to know the book of Psalms and the book of Proverbs, because you need to know how to do this, because I ain't gonna always be with you. So she taught me how to pray. You don't know how to pray? Then write the prayer out the night before. Put it under your pillow. Y'all, some of you young people don't know about that. Put it under your pillow. So you'll remember it and get up in the morning at 5 and pray. Every morning for a year at 5 o'clock in the morning, I got up and I prayed. The only time I did not get up at 5 o'clock in the morning is when I was in labor. So God fashioned me. My mother at that time was the woman hands on. When I got to Columbus, I ran into Dr. Anderson, and she continued to what my mother had left undone. So I stand before you as Elder Pratt, because two women stood in the gap as a partner. Amen?
Amen.
I hope you received the word today. Now, is anybody ready to come on down to the potter so that he can fashion you? Because you're tired of living just as clay, but you want to be made into something that he can use. If you want the meaning, you're ready to give your life to Christ. If that is so, come on down and meet the potter. Amen.
All right. Amen. Amen.
Maybe. Now, Pastor tells us that we can repent at home. And you can get it right with God at your house. And you can. If you have been in a black backslidden state and you just want to come on down to the potter today and make it right again and be getting ready to be fashioned, come on down today. All right? Maybe you want COCC and Dr. Anderson to be your plate, your potter's wheel, the place where you're going through life and it's turning around and you don't know which way to turn, and you need a good, solid person, a pastor, somebody who will get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, somebody who will push the plate back and pray for you, somebody that'll fast for you, somebody will get in the trenches, which if you need that kind of pastor and that kind of church home, then come on down and come and join Community Outreach Church of Columbus. All right, it looks like we're all here saved today.
Come on and give God a hand. It's funny when you don't get paid, but people look at you shaking when you get off day. Yeah. I don't get paid, but I just took a day off, amen. I'm mad about it. But not one thing, I don't want y'all to think I complain about what God has not given me. I believe He has a purpose in the way. And you can't sow a seed in the Lord and not reap a harvest. Y'all know that, right?
Amen.
I'm sowing the seed. And as people, I don't think I'm unappreciated. God sent a woman that I ain't seen in 10 years to come back and thank me. For those who think that I don't do enough, I was a neophyte when